أنا في غني سونغ عربي سونغ ما في كويس سونغ فلوبس وايد خلي ولي خلي ولي خلي ولي صوت كويس وايد خلي ولي خلي ولي خلي ولي
باي ما في كركر يا
وايد خلي ولي خلي ولي خلي ولي
هلو مرة
وايد خلي ولي ولي هذا كفيل البس أبيض قلب كله أسود هو في كل يوم
I study PhD in translation, and my background into this was basically my interest in languages. And I don't know about you, while living in the UAE, you start noticing that there are lots of languages, at least within your social vicinity. When I was growing up, sure, school was in English, home was in Arabic, but also friends would speak all sorts of other languages. I mean, we had friends who spoke Armenian, friends who spoke Russian, Korean, Hindi, Malayalam, all sorts of languages, right? And at some point you start noticing that all of those languages are here, like within your small social network, not through the internet or anything like that. It's just, you know, your neighbors, people you work with, friends at school, you know, in all of these places. So at some point, you know, what brought these languages here? And more interestingly is what happens when they're here. And, you know, although I don't do research full-time on this particular topic, it's a topic that's extremely interesting to me. Typically, people think of UAE as a place that, you know, the natives speak Arabic only, and foreigners show up, and then they speak English to these people, and you know, that's about it, right? But obviously, that's just the typical simple answer. And when you start looking, kind of scratching the surface, and you look underneath, you're going to see that there's a lot of these other languages, obviously because of work and these things, right? So, if you look at the local Emirati population, they don't only speak Arabic, they speak also other languages at home. So I'll go through these and also go through languages and, you know, dialects of Arabic that migrants brought into the country. And then also something called a pidgin, or a contact language, that had to be constructed in some way because people work together in, you know, in workplaces. So in the Emirates, the population here is not all, you know, nomadic Arabs who live just on the coast, but you also have what you could call urban Arabs. Not necessarily urban in the sense that they lived in cities, but in the sense that they weren't moving around all the time. So you have the people living in the coast, and I'm speaking in the sense of the last 200 years. You have people living on the coast, typically interacting with people on the other side of the coast, on the other side of the sea, in India, Eastern Africa, northern parts of the Gulf. And this particular community of people speak a dialect of Arabic. I mean, you could also call it a language, right? The language dialect is very arbitrary, typically simply a political differentiation. But they spoke something fairly similar all across the coast because they interacted a lot with one another. So you have researchers show up and, you know, they do research, and they call this group the Khaliji Arabic, the Gulf Arabic. Whereas there's differences also in different parts of the coast. So people who are in Kuwait speak something that's Khaliji Arabic in turn, but is slightly different from what people in Qatar, people in Abu Dhabi, Dubai, Sharjah, all the way up to Ras Al Khaimah speak. And then this particular set of Arabics, set of Khaliji Arabics, also picked up from other languages that they had to interact with because of trade. So you have traders leaving basically the Gulf area, going to India, going to Eastern Africa. And there's a lot of words that came in through Persian, through Hindi, through Swahili, into Arabic. And we don't really think about them often, but it tells us a lot of how the communities here interacted with other communities, basically around the sea. But you also have other forms of Arabic spoken in, you know, at least in the Emirates. You have a particular tribe in the Northern Emirates known as the Shakur, the Shaki tribe. And this is the tribe that you could say has been around for at least 1,500 years. Because one of the earliest civil wars that happened during the early Islamic era was the Ridda Wars, and there was one battlefield that was in Diba. If you go to Fujairah, Diba is somewhere there. So people there speak a dialect that's very different from what other, and it would probably be considered the most distant dialect from what people on the coast speak. People consider it difficult to understand, fast. But what's interesting about it is it's very, very well possible that this dialect has been around for a very long time without having to deal with other forms of Arabic. You also have dialects of the Arabic that was spoken by Bedouin tribes deeper into the desert. Not on the coast, but places like Al-Ain, Liwa, and various Bedouin tribes that have been going across for the length of history, basically. And they also have their own dialect. You would see a lot of it used in TV shows that kind of portray Bedouin dramas, all sorts of Bedouin shows, but also in poetry. There's a lot of interest in kind of using that particular dialect in poetry that's called Nabati poetry. It's a particular genre of poetry, and it's typically, you'll typically see it if you've ever heard of the Sha'ar al-Milyon, the poet of the millions. And it's a reality show. It's kind of like pop idols. So they present poetry, they perform it, and then they keep progressing until someone wins that million. You also have another dialect of Arabic that is also native in the region, and it's also historical because it hasn't interacted with a lot of the other Arabics that have been around. And you would also call it an urban Arabic, kind of like the Shakur, the Shahur tribes dialect, right? So you have the Bahana dialect, which is typically spoken in Bahrain, but it has large communities in Kuwait, the Eastern Province of Saudi, the UAE, Oman, and for a very long time also in Zanzibar. And this dialect is also very different from other dialects in the region. One of the most interesting things that are going on, and it's a well-researched dialect. One of the researchers happens to live in Jumeirah, and he's been there for years. And one of the interesting things that happens to this dialect, in Bahrain, it's not actually a prestige dialect, because it's basically the dialect of the poor communities in Bahrain. So people don't really learn to speak that unless they're in the community. And then when people who speak it natively start working in, say, government departments, if they get employed in government departments or in other parts of Bahrain where this dialect isn't really prominent, they start switching their dialect. And although it's not an issue here, it happens also. It's only spoken at home. And then when Bahraini speakers leave and they meet you for coffee, they're going to speak the regular dominant dialect. And it's something that happens in most countries, most communities, that there is particular dialects that are kind of ignored by the dominant mainstream communities. And people from these non-dominant communities would kind of switch into speaking the dominant dialects and languages. One thing you see this happening in, not in dialectal form, like not in the languages that you would consider Arabic, you would see it in the other communities among the Emiratis where they don't speak this language. At home they speak, say, Bilji, Lawati, various Lari dialects, which is locally called Aini or Khodmani. And you have lots of families who speak it at home, or at least their older generation does, and then younger generations don't really speak it well, or they can understand what's spoken to, but not really. And this particular issue is going on in all the language communities that are not Arabic language communities. So, Biduchis, Jagaris, Nawakis, all of these different communities, they would, if you'd ask a lot of their younger generations, why aren't we learning these languages? They'd say, you know, it's not going to get us a job, you know, it's not going to take us anywhere. And this particular argument is much more prominent in the smaller communities. All of these different languages have very interesting histories of what brought them here, because there was a lot of interaction with a lot of different parts of the Gulf, right? And all of this interaction has been going on for centuries, you know, I'd guess 500 years, right? You would have, obviously, because in southern Iran you have the Lari languages, and there was a lot of trade and a lot of people moving here and a lot of people from here moving there. So you also have a lot of Arabic being spoken in southern Iran. You would also have Baluchis who have moved here over the last 500 years, mostly also earlier in 19th and early 20th century when there was a lot of migration immigration coming in where there was a lot of employment in this area. And large communities of Baluchis moved here, and for a long time they do speak it. A lot of the young ones still speak it, but not all of them. An acquaintance of mine says he had to learn it later on in his life because his parents would like refuse to teach him because they said, you know, it's not going to take you anywhere. In like all of these languages I just mentioned are also spoken in Oman because we have a very similar kind of history with Oman. So you have the Lawati language that is spoken here has its large community in Oman in a city called Mutar, right close to Muscat. And over the last 200 years, many traders from the Lawati community moved here, and they speak it, they still speak it. A few of my friends who are from that community speak these languages, but not really. I mean, think of acquaintances of yours who have lived in other countries, and they understand what their parents say, they can't formulate the sentences. So you have those languages that are spoken by Emiratis, but you also have other languages by migrants coming in from other countries. So obviously, since 1971, obviously before that there was a lot of languages from other places. You had a large number of migrants coming in from India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka. You had a lot of migrants coming in from Northern Africa. You had families coming in from Burma, China, and obviously Europe, because, you know, at the time of the before the 60s, from the 1820s all the way to the 1971, we were a British protectorate, right? So we had a lot of interaction through Britain with other countries. And we've inherited English through that. But, you know, let's go back to how these migrant languages showed up. So obviously with the growth of the bureaucracy after, you know, the petrol and oil industry started growing, you had a lot of people coming in, a lot from Egypt, Iraq, Syria, Yemen, and that's because along with a growing oil industry, you also had a growing state bureaucracy that needed work. And obviously, at the time, you had a very small population, and a lot of them were still in schools. So someone had to do the work in these bureaucracies and in these organizations. So there was a lot of migration coming in because there was a lot of jobs. So you had Egyptian Arabic, particularly in schools, because there's a lot of school teachers who spoke Egyptian Arabic. So you have a lot of, say, my parents' generation grew up interacting with Egyptian Arabic every day because they went to school and they heard that particular dialect every day. And you had a lot of Syrian Arabic, Iraqi Arabic also, and they're very different forms also, kind of like the Emirates, different dialects for different areas in these countries. Also coming in and being a part of the Emirates, you know, people speaking in this community, in the city, right? And then you had migrants coming in from South Asia. And they worked in all sorts of jobs, right? You had merchants, you also had migrant workers working in construction, in also the oil industry, in manufacturing jobs, in in the shipyards and places like that. So they brought in their own languages, and also some also brought in, managed to bring in their families. So there was this growing of this, these communities that speak all these languages. And one of the interesting things that have been happening since that has happened is this contact language. Basically, if you are working with someone and you have no common language, you will still try to communicate in one way or another, right? So you will start using words from your own language and words you've learned from his language and kind of make do with what you have. And this is a very common thing that happens everywhere in the world. The Caribbean islands have these creoles that have grown from what is called the pidgin. These are contact languages also, because you have the slave trade bringing people from Africa. So they have their African languages, Yoruba, and other languages. And they had to interact with the English overlords at the time, right? So there was this kind of intermixing of the language. So you have a lot of Yoruba grammar with a lot of English-derived words in some of the Caribbean languages. And speaking of the slave trade, another language that is spoken here in the Emirates that was brought in because of the slave trade from Eastern Africa was Swahili. And this also has been going on for centuries. This has only happened to me a few days ago, and my mom was telling me about a story. Obviously, because the slave trade was going on, there were slaves living with many families. There's this story of a cat who was pregnant, and she was telling someone, one of the servants in a house, to go to another house and tell the cat over there something. And the sentence was in Swahili. Obviously, because I don't speak the language, I can figure out what it was and, you know, what it sounded like. But when that servant did do that, the cat said, you know, why didn't you tell me earlier? Turns out the cat was giving birth and, you know, she talked to the servant in the language that the masters didn't speak. And you still do have communities of Emiratis who still speak Swahili. Not only Afro-Emiratis, but also Emiratis who moved here after the Zanzibar Revolution in the 60s. And they still speak it at home. They're interested in learning that language. It's not as much as, it's not a dire situation as the other languages where the youth aren't really that interested in learning the language. The Zanzibari community has managed to keep in touch with one another and kind of keep the language going. So with going back to that contact language, the first time it's been noticed by any researcher was in the 60s. So this guy called something Smart, John Smart, I guess, wrote in a paper in the 90s that in the 60s he was sent by one of the oil companies to teach Arabic to people working in Atlanta. So when he was there, he started noticing that there is this communication going on between the Arabic-speaking laborers and laborers coming from South Asia, but also the managers coming in from Europe. And he noticed that this is a fairly simplified form of Arabic with a lot of, you know, different features from the typical Arabic spoken in Oman. And you have this this contact language going on in Arabic spoken in the wrong way. But to me, with it being spoken, having grammar, having poetry, music, I think that that brings it up into a level where it's spoken by people. Obviously, what would be even more interesting is if it developed into what linguists call creoles. So the difference between a pidgin and a creole is a creole is spoken as a native language, but a pidgin is not. So suppose this language is given to a second generation, to kids, basically, who grow up speaking this as, you know, their native language. They would be seeing, you know, one of the things that happens with languages is that you get to see the world through that lens, through the lens of language. Obviously, this is like, you know, debated within the linguistic circles. They, you know, they're at each other's throats. Some people like to say that, you know, linguistics, you know, language is the lens that we see the world, and others say, no, no, no. We speak language because we see the world in a certain way. But out of my own experience with dealing with linguistics and things like that, is that through people's use of languages, you get to see their own world. You might not see it perfectly, but you get to see at least a side of it that kind of clarifies, makes it a bit better to understand what they're going through, their own experiences. And, you know, with all these languages we, you know, just spoke about, what I would want people to think about is whenever, I mean, so I, whenever I'm driving, I have this habit of switching radio channels constantly. I just don't stop. And while doing that, you know, think of all the languages that you can recognize, right? That's part of the things that happen to me while I'm driving, if I'm driving long, you know, fairly long drive. And I mean, I want people to kind of think about that. You know, not simply take that, oh, you know, I work with people who speak these languages. But rather, you know, there are these languages that are around me. What do I get out of them? How do I see things differently? So basically, that's how I ended up doing translation studies, because you get a chance to see things in a very different way, and not take language for granted. So yeah, that's about it.